Hi, I'm Nan Simonson, and today is another session of PowerPoints, points of interest about lifestyle as medicine. This began as a 14-week purposeful journey going through the acronym in my book, which is Powerfully. And each of those is a word that has to do with the pillars of lifestyle medicine, and then some additional sharing. But the concept is great. Lifestyle as medicine is a subject that we could talk on forever, and PowerPoints, points of interest, make it that much more, I'll just say valuable, I hope. Today, I'm talking about daily non-negotiables, and I have seven areas of non-negotiables that are what I practice on a daily basis, unless, for example, I'll be spending a couple of weeks in Europe coming up soon, and there will be some differences. And if I don't sleep well because I'm ruminating, and I know how to get past rumination, but there are nights I just can't. And so instead of the 8 hours I'm set up for, I'll end up sleeping in because I want my 8 hours, and usually get up at 6, but sometimes later if there was an interrupted night. So I'm going to talk about these non-negotiable categories and then fill in with the things that are relevant in those categories. And I know as soon as I finish, I'll think, oh, why didn't I say this and that? And while I'm talking, you may think, stop talking. This is more than I even want to think about. But we're all individuals, and that is as it may be. So I'm going to first talk about a morning routine. I always have a morning routine. Oh, and before I go any further, I even have a note to myself, da-da, to say to you that right next door, they're putting in all new window frames. And I think, I don't know how long, for how long, or how many days we're going to be hearing this buzzsaw, but that's what's going on over there. And I hope I'm loud enough. It looks like I am. So I'm sorry for the buzz in the background. Okay, morning routine. And it's almost always the same. And it's non-negotiable in some of these practices that I believe are essential. For example, as soon as I wake up, I take a moment to think about my day. I take a moment to reflect my mission. My mission was written in my book. I don't know what this note is there. And my mission is to pass along what I so fervently believe is a message that everybody should understand, and that is that through lifestyle as medicine and the adoption of certain behaviors, we can extend our health span and therefore our happy lifespan by adopting practices that have been shown to be valuable that our body really likes. It doesn't forego every possibility that could happen in our life, but it certainly can stave off probably 80% of the chronic illness that we see around us in this country that is absolutely traceable to lifestyle. So morning routine, repeat my mission to myself and think of the day in terms of whether or not I have opportunities or can make them. In other words, I set my attention. I stretch. I do some basic stretches in bed. I do cat-cow. I do laying on my back splits to get my hip flexors moving. I'll sit up and touch my toes and go sideways and twist my spine and do thread the needle while I'm doing cat-cow. Those are yoga poses. Cat-cow is when you get on your hands and your knees and you flex your back up like a cat going shh and down as if it's a cow, you know, heavy with what cows are heavy with in their stomach. and some other stretches. So that's just what I do every morning. And I even do it when we're on holidays. I just like the idea of getting things moving while my body is still warm, not overdoing, not over demanding, but just some basic stretches. You see every animal, cats, dogs, etc., do something like that, usually upon waking. I make my bed every morning, even when we're on vacation, and I make it in bed. There are several layers that are the bed, and so I simply pull them up and then lay them down all the way across. It's a king size bed. And then get out and straighten it out and put the pillows on that are going to be on. But I make my bed because, and there was a whole thing about that, even a book about that. And there was a lecture about that. What was his name? Colonel McLean, is that it? Who did a talk at one of the top universities. And what he said to the graduates was, make your bed. It's a way to start the day with intention, and all day long, you'll know you've done something purposeful, et cetera, et cetera. Go downstairs and have a glass of water, big glass of water, and I make a cup of matcha tea. The matcha tea is tea leaves, and it's ceremonial grade, and it's organic. It's tea leaves that are ground up, and you drink the tea leaves. Tea has a lot of antioxidants, and even more so when you actually drink the tea itself. And so I have a cup of matcha tea. We've got a couple of cats. I feed the cats. I clean the litter boxes. There are three of them. They're indoor cats, and there are catteries, a cattery upstairs, cattery downstairs, and they sleep in our entertainment room, the TV room, because they are demanding all night long of being petted. And we found that we couldn't sleep with them roaming the house. And we don't have a door to the bedroom. It's an upstairs attic that doesn't have a door. Big, big room, 400 square feet, but no door. And they just come and go. So it's more information than you needed, but there you have it. That's why there's three litter boxes, because the one in the TV room, I open up for them at night and then close up later so that they'll use the catteries outside. I set up for my breakfast and my coffee. Yes, I do drink coffee. It's a 3/4 decaf, 1/4 calf, organic, responsibly sourced coffee. But I don't eat breakfast until after I exercise, and I'll talk about that. I usually, at least 4 times a week, get in the infrared sauna. We have a near and far infrared sauna that before we chose it, 6-7 years ago, I researched to find one that was neutral or no, what they could call no EMFs, electromagnetic frequency. Radiation, because you can get in a box like that, that is made poorly. And basically while you're doing one thing to help yourself, zap yourself in other ways. And so mine's a clear light sauna. And I've tested it because I have an EMF meter, and it's about 2 milligauss. And 3 is where they start, over 3 is where they start seeing some cellular changes. And so I feel safe in that. And then I do a cold water outdoor shower, go outside and whatever the temperature is, I shower, soap and all out there. I've got it all set up. And then number 2, there's movement, non-negotiable every day, first thing in the morning. It's easier that way. Wake up in time to exercise. My husband does the same thing. And in order for him to get the sauna in and the exercise and get to his office when he wants to, he has to get up at 4:30. And so that's what he does. So the day is set for these intentions, these non-negotiables for both of us. And the next non-negotiable is that there's movement every day in the morning and in the evening. Every night after dinner, we take a half an hour walk. It's good for digestion. It jiggles the bowels. It gets things going, and it lowers glucose levels substantially when you move after a meal. It makes a difference. If you speak to a monitored diabetic, monitored meaning they have a continuous glucose meter, they will be able to tell you how they can see the numbers drop with movement after a meal. It really makes a difference. So the movement begins sometimes in the sauna, because the sauna is in my husband's, well, it's actually the garage that was changed into a soundproof music room. He's a drummer. No, he's a CPA, tax attorney, and drummer. He drummed, he did that on the side in a band for decades and decades, I think until he was about 45. And so he has his drum kit out there. It's a music room for jamming, but also the sauna's there and weights are there. And so I'll bring in weights into the sauna, especially at the beginning of it before I get too hot. And I'll work on arms because I can do arms easily. It's harder because it's a tighter area to do legs, but I'll do arms and I'll do some squats in there. So I could be doing that, or I could be reading in there, or I could be listening to a podcast. Then I'm outside in the sun, in the light. Dr. Andrew Huberman of Stanford University, who is a neurobiologist, an ophthalmologist, can't say enough that when we get light in our eyes, even if it's a cloudy day, even if it's in a northern hemisphere, there's usually protons enough in the air to affect us, it will set up our circadian clock to do what that clock is meant to do, which is get light in the eyes. Ah, it's daytime. It lets the pineal gland know that about 13, 14 hours later, it is to release melatonin and take it from there in terms of getting that cycle, the wake up and the sleep cycle going. And I know it's made a difference for me because I'm able to sleep well for a lot of reasons. One, because of the exercise during the day, and well, a lot of things, and I'll mention a couple of things later. But by the same token, it has allowed me to sleep without the use of medications, and I'm really happy about that. So you get your face out in the sun, you get your eyes out in the sun, not staring at the sun, but you let the sun, even for 2 to 5 minutes, let you know, let your body know that the day has begun. Quite often I'll do sun salutations, even just 2 or 3 of them. If you know yoga, you know what that is. I have a mat in the garage area that's still a part of a garage. And I have a mat out there, and I'll get into the light and I'll do some sun salutations for the stretching of it. Not every morning, but I do that quite often. I either do a 45 minute to an hour walk up our nearby mountain or around our nearby park, or I'll cycle for 30 to 60 minutes. I am back doing a yoga practice in a studio, usually twice a week. And I love that. I miss doing that during yoga, during COVID. And I thought I would do full practices at home, and I didn't. I even paid for programs that people had online, and I just didn't follow it. Whereas if I have a place I have to be, and I'm there working for an hour and 15 minutes, even beyond what I would make myself do, I'll do things that I know I want to do and that are good for me because I'm there. Isometrics. A lot of people don't realize the value of isometrics. For example, I'm sitting here squeezing my glutes really, really hard and then releasing. I do the same thing in the car. My son, it was funny because he, when he was younger, he would say, "Mom, are you exercising your arms?" Because he would see me on the steering wheel doing this. It's actually good for the pecs, the pectorals, you know, squeezing the and the shoulders and the arms. At 72, none of these things look all that great anymore. The rear end is lower than it used to be. The arms have some really weird texture. But you know what? At 72, it could be a heck of a lot worse. And so these little efforts that don't really mean much of anything when you're doing it, because it's you're, for example, in the car, I'm sitting there anyway, I can squeeze the steering wheel that way. They add up and they make a difference. Balance work. I know that, and you'll hear it all the time from older people who have fallen. They get fearful of falling, and quite often they won't even go out much because they fear falling. We have to work on our balance all the time. We do that in yoga, but I'll also do that at home. For example, when I'm, let's say, there's something else I do in self-care. So I'll talk to you about that as it relates to face stuff. But I'll do that and I'll stand on one leg, or I'll do a tree pose, a partial tree pose. In other words, against my calves as opposed to against the upper thigh. And I'll do that just to make sure that I still can balance on one leg. We did something on yoga last week where we had a strap on the floor and we had to walk 1 foot in front of the other, 1 foot in front of the other, and then backwards. And that showed me that I'm not excellent at balance. But one of the things that I've made myself do, I heard this somewhere and I decided, well, I'm going to do that. And even when I don't feel like it, I'll do it anyway. When I put on, for example, tennis shoes, socks, and then the tennis shoe, I'll do it on one leg. And I would say to you, if you're going to try this, do it where you can grab something when you lose balance. Some days I am so clean and perfect at it. One leg goes up and I'll stand up and I don't know if I can show you. I really can't. I'll stand up and I hold that foot and I put cream on it. Then I put the sock on it. And then I put the shoe on it, bending down to get it off the floor and put it on all on one leg. And then the next leg, some days I'll fall over too easily. Not on the ground, but I have a chair, all of this in the closet. I have a chair in the closet that I can balance myself on. So balance work. Do it on a regular basis, if not on a daily basis. You can do it easily on a daily basis without it being a big deal. And then even right now, I have this thing called QBII, C-U-B-I-I, under my desk. I just did an hour and 45 minutes with a group, a support group that I work with through lifestyle medicine. I'm doing this podcast. I'll do our Zoom session. I'll do I do things throughout the week. You can't tell if I'm doing this. I have to kind of hold still. You'll see the earrings jingle maybe a little bit, or this time it's kind of squeaking, but I'm pedaling under the desk. Why? Because it keeps motion going. We want to keep our blood flowing and our muscles tensing, because that is what pushes lymphatic system, or the lymph, for your lymphatic system. It doesn't have a heart that beats it like your blood does. And it just keeps your body moving. And moving is the new, not moving is the new smoking. Sitting is the new smoking, because our body really demands and really wants to be moved. So something like this, if I'm going to sit anyway, and allows me to do it. I don't do it the entire time, but there are times, for example, I was working on something at my desk last night, and man, I pushed it only for just a few minutes, but not just before going to bed. Otherwise, that might be too stimulating. So number three, daily whole food plant-based meals. I have now for 5 years eaten a whole food plant-based diet. That means whole food plant exclusive. Why don't I just say vegan? Because vegan doesn't say whole food. It says there's no animal in here, and yet it could still be highly processed, highly sugared, and full of oils. And that's not the way I eat. Whole food, plant-based. I home cook throughout the week. We go out one night for dinner, and sometimes the housekeeper comes every other week, and that day, I don't cook. We go out to lunch, and so we'll go to Chipotle because I can make a meal of just plant-based foods, no animal product, no oil. And so that would be the one lunch out. Oh, and then on Sunday, that's true. We go to a vegan place for our brunch every Sunday. And that's a great day. We just love our Sundays, because then we go to the farmer's market, this huge tent with freshly picked things every day. here in Riverside. It's called the Corona Family Farms, and we just love that. So we make our own meals, because anything that you get in a restaurant or that you get in fast food or that you get processed is going to have far more salt, sodium in it than you would want if you were really counting, and far more oil than you want. We don't need to put oil in our foods because there are plenty of foods that have oil in them. Soy, for example, which I eat soy, I eat tofu all the time, daily almost, and soy milk, that has a high percentage of fat, but it's all bound to the product itself. We eat olives. They have olive oil. We prefer that than having it squeezed out at 120 calories per tablespoon. I can eat a pound of broccoli for that many calories. And what do they do for me? Nothing. I get enough oil from the foods. I don't need it from oils. And Dr. Esselstyn said that's the best way to keep your arteries clear as well. So three meals a day. Some people are only doing two and one meal a day. I do three. I have breakfast after exercising. So we exercise fasted. And I come back, and it depends on what I'm doing at the time. But my breakfasts lately have been just, well, a bowl of berries. You can get frozen berries. They're less expensive that way, mixed berries, but we use fresh berries, strawberry, raspberry, blueberry, and blackberry, and chia and flaxseed, because that's our omega-3s, and that's protein, and that's fiber, and just a couple of tablespoons of the oat groats, and then put water in it. I don't mean water, soy milk, and the whole thing turns into a slurry while it sits there when I go up the mountain and cycling. And so I have this bowl of this cold porridge that I just love. But I've done a number of things for breakfast. They were smoothies sometimes and my savory oats sometimes. And so it's all right to change things up, but it's also all right to do the same thing all the time. That's what my husband tends to do. I seldom snack between meals because I'm so full from a good, healthy breakfast or lunch or dinner that I don't want to eat anything else. It wouldn't be a big deal if I was having whole food plant-based foods between meals, but I just don't need to. And I kind of like that. You may have heard me talk about the migrating motor complex. Look that up. That's when our body sort of cleans out the digestive chute 3 to 4 hours after a meal, 2 to 3 hours, 3 to 4 hours. And so I want it to do that. I want it to do its peristalsis, which it will do if there's nothing in there, or if we've finished a meal and there's nothing added. And so I kind of like that idea. It's sort of an inspiring thing to not have snacks for, because I know I'm getting a bodily function that my body is set up ancestrally to do. It must know what it's doing. And then we stop eating 2 to 3 hours before bedtime. So the goal is always to be finished eating by 6 or 6:30. And because I don't eat again until almost 9 after my exercise, that's about a 15-hour fast. And there are a lot of people with a lot of evidence saying that a fast like that is good for our body. Dr. Longo, who is an expert in longevity, Dr. Volter Longo, says even a 12-hour fast, which would be your last meal ending at 7, your breakfast at 7, that's 12 hours. It's when you probably wouldn't be eating anyway, is good for any body. Anyway, so that's another thing that is part of our non-negotiables. Lunch is always the same for me, and enormous, and I mean about a pound to a pound and a quarter. Mixed salad. I even have on my YouTube channel, YouTube Nan Simonson, I have a example of how I do my chopped salads, a massive amount of greens and a bunch of other stuff all chopped up, and it's a meal that has every color of the rainbow, lots and lots and lots of fiber, lots of variety and nutrients galore. And dinner is a combination of legumes and grains and fruits and vegetables. And it's a combination of really good whole plant food that we're finished with, as I said, usually by 6:30. Hydration throughout the day. 8 to 10 glasses of water is a good thing to aim for. But instead of chugging a big bolus of water that your body doesn't absorb that quickly, you can sip throughout the day and just have a bottle with you and just sip on it throughout the day. Mindful eating, taking the time to chew, especially on a whole food plant-based diet with so much fiber, taking the time to chew. I have to remind myself of that, but I actually do. There was a time that I practiced chewing 20 chews or 25 chews. They'll say do it 30 times, but there's nothing left in my mouth after 30 times. So I don't, and which is the point. But I chew until it's chewed to a cream, until it gets to a well, I love this word, macerated. In other words, it's all well macerated mouthful. That way you can digest it better. You get the vitamins out of it better. It causes less indigestion, especially if you're having beans and cruciferous vegetables that your body could really struggle to digest. And no alcohol. My husband used to have wine with every meal. Until January, and he got convinced by Dr. Huberman when I snuck in a talk of Dr. Huberman's on a trip, and he heard what he said about alcohol being a neurotoxin, how it affects memory, how it increases the chances of Alzheimer's and dementia. And said, "Nah, I think I'll eat, drink less," and then within, meaning a glass instead of two glasses. And then next thing I knew, he said, "Yeah, I think I'll not drink." And he hasn't. So it's going on 10 months now, which is just fine because I don't either. Okay. And then number four. So it was the morning routine. Movement was number two. Daily whole food plant-based meals, number three. Number four, do something toward my mission. I explained what my mission is to pass along the word. So I educate myself daily. I always listen to podcasts, and I can do that easily on my walks and my cycles, on my cycling ride. And when I'm making my breakfast, I can get through, well, Dr. Huberman and Rich Roll have 2 and 3 hour podcasts. Most of them, like Chef AJ, an hour to an hour and a half, interviewing people who have something to say, something that we can learn from. And so I do that on a daily basis. I shoot a cooking demonstration on a weekly basis, and I shoot this video on a weekly basis. But in the meantime, I communicate on social media and return every comment, a comment back to everybody who writes me. I don't monetize my channels. I do this because it's part of the mission. And I'm also a lifestyle medical coach. I work with a lifestyle medical practice as their health and lifestyle coach. And I do that on a weekly basis as well. And then self-care, number five. Oh boy. I was a landscape designer for nearly 20 years. That was a business of mine, Nanscapes. And I designed, about 230 gardens in our area, our gardens, my gardens. I didn't install them. I had a crew that installed them. But my gardens, the design and the installation once they were done and established, won a number of Waterwise Garden Awards. And I'm really proud of that. So I spend time in my garden doing something, little trimming of something. It's a very full garden. And so there's always something to do, even though we have a weekly gardener. I have a routine that I do on a weekly basis. I'll call it the beauty routine. And that is that I wash my face every morning and every night. I use something called a Foreo. It's a a vibrating little silicone thing. And I would have sworn, because I've done it for 8 years, 9 years, that it, even though it was simply meant to clean pores and all, that it firmed my skin, because I noticed that I was tighter along the jawline. And I looked it up once as Foreo for tightening skin. And several people said, now they don't say it's for this, but I've noticed that. But then I bought something that is for uplifting skin, and it's called, and I bought that maybe a year ago, and it's called New Face, NuFace. And it's microcurrent, and it's actually registered with the FDA or accepted by the FDA to do what it says it's going to do. And that is that it just kind of tightens the structure under the skin. And so I do that on an almost daily basis. It takes about 5 minutes, and it's just pulling it along the neck and the face. So I do that. Now, you know, and I think it helps. I think any little thing helps. Still, when I catch sun on my face, it's really easy to look really good right now because the light is right. But when I catch sun on my face outside, I'll think, yeah, I see those wrinkles. They're there. And then I use pure products, something called Beauty Counter, something called Andalou, pure cosmetics with sunscreen. So I have a serum, and I have a Korean night cream and a day cream. I always keep moisture, and I always use sunscreen on my face before I go out for my rides, even though it's 7 in the morning. I get a massage once in a while, at least once a month. I'll have a massage, 60 to 90 minutes, good for you, and it feels really good. I remind myself on a regular basis to stop comparing and to stop criticizing. I think some of you know that I'm dyslexic and I have ADHD. It's really hard for me to stay on task, which means my brain doesn't work quite the way other people's do, but it's served me well for all these years. I have other things. It's like someone who can't see well, they hear better. So I think in certain ways that really served me well as a landscape designer. And then before that, for 28 years, if my Tupperware career, when I trained people to succeed, and we sold millions of dollars worth of product a year under my tutelage, and my husband's running the business, my late husband. All of that to say that I can be really hard on myself, because I'll catch myself doing something and berate myself. You know, you did that again, Nan. And there was a person, Brian Tracy, who in sales, you also listen to podcasts, who always said, look at yourself in the mirror and say, I like myself. I like myself, or I love myself. I'll say to myself, I am fine just the way I am, and I'm going to make it work any way I can. So be nice to yourself. Be as nice to yourself as you would be to others. Gratitude every day. I thank the powers that be. I thank the creator of the universe, whomever that is, for all the blessings in my life and those whom I know and care about. I do loving kindness meditation all the time. And it's a four-part, I'll say, prayer. May he be safe and protected. May he be happy and joyful. May he be healthy and strong. May he be at peace and at ease. And it's really, may he, may she, may I be safe, but I add the protected. May I be happy, and I add the joyful. May I be healthy, and I add the strong. May I be at ease. It's a beautiful prayer. You send it out to everybody. You send it out to groups. You send it out to someone you pass in the street. You send it out to someone you're mad at. It does good things for you. That's self-care. I'm not talking about metaphysics here, even though some people believe that if enough people do that, anybody does that, because our world is energy, it's going to be felt across the miles. I don't know, but I know that it does me good. There's a book, Love 2.0, that talks a lot about this. And I love that book, Dr. Frederickson. I believe it's Frederickson, Love 2.0. Good book. I avoid toxic products in my house and on my body. I pay a ton of attention to that because everything that's made now, almost everything, has toxic products in it. There's a book, Fatal Conveniences, that Olean is his last name, just published. And again, what we don't want is to be breathing things, wearing things, experiencing, even dressing in things that are hormone disruptors or have PFAS chemicals, those forever chemicals that when you get in your body, stay there. So pay attention to those. I do. I avoid them and I pay attention to what they are. So all of my products are clean. I don't use fabric softeners, anything like that, unless it's something from seventh generation or some of those other products. And I don't use fabric softener. And then I floss and I water pick and I brush twice a day. Actually, water pick in the middle of the day too. Oh, this is so gross. There's nothing better. It happened this morning or this afternoon. I had my salad, big giant, my kind of salad, lots and lots. It's colors of the scarf. And when I was water picking, I was doing that fast to get on this podcast. It looked like confetti in my sink. I've said this before. And I was so proud of it. It was like, look at all the colors of what I'm putting in my body. Thank you, salad. Okay, 6 and 7. Connect with other people. Number 6, hugs and kisses to my husband every day. That's part of his love language. He loves that extension of emotion. He loves texts with a bunch of hearts on it. He loves kisses. I won't go any further than that. And it makes him happy. What makes him happy makes me happy. He is husband number 2. My first passed away after 40 years of marriage. And oh God, it still chokes me up. And I've been married to Tim for 11 years. So that's what, 50, 51 years of marriage. And whatever makes somebody happy will come back to honor you as well. Text or call a friend. I try every day to keep my community close because we need community in our life. And everywhere I go, on my bike rides, on my walks, I don't care where or who this person is or what rags they're wearing, I'll walk by them or ride by them and say, good morning, look them in the eye, good morning, because too many times people simply walk by each other, right by each other, and ignore each other. That's not necessary. Occasionally, I'll say good morning and I won't get an answer and I don't care. It doesn't matter. That person has been acknowledged and I think that matters. And then number 7 is prioritize sleep and stress management. 7 to 9 hours of sleep must be prioritized. It's so important for us. Lights out in my case at 10, and then I can wake up at 6 and do my morning routine. Tim goes to bed at 8:30, so he can wake up at 4:30 and do his morning routine. You have to practice sleep hygiene to make that happen. You stay out of bright light at night. All the lights are lower angled and dim. In the house, there's nothing excitatory going on. We go out for a walk, but it's an hour or so before we go to bed, and it's not overly vigorous. We don't watch excitatory types of things. As a matter of fact, we shouldn't even have that blue light in our eyes, but sometimes on the weekend, we'll treat ourselves to a movie and then go to bed. And it's not ideal, but that's okay. Meditation, AM or PM or both, at least 10 minutes, sitting back, eyes closed, just watching your breath. And it doesn't matter if you think other things, push them away, let them float away like a cloud, go back to your breath. Let another thought come, let it float away, go back to your breath. That is the simplest form of meditation. And even that, for 10 minutes has proven to benefit your brain and calm your spirit and calm your mood. Physiological sighs, you'll hear Dr. Huberman talk about that to calm you down. If you exhale longer than you inhale, it slows your heart. If you inhale fast and exhale, no, if you inhale deeply and exhale fast, it speeds up your heart. In other words, Wim Hof breathing, like, will get your heart pumping. A long inhale, count of 8, count of 10, will slow down your heart, but it also calms you down. That's a physiological sigh. It's a breathing in again at the top of it. A lot longer out than what I just did. That calms you down. And your body does that all the time because it's an exchange of oxygen and carbon dioxide. And it gets that balance going and calms you down. But you can do that on your own anytime you need to calm yourself down. And then finally, no debt. Isn't that a weird thing to say? When my husband passed away, it would have been much harder if we had been debt ridden. But we had decided before that in our lives that we would live debt free. We always paid off credit card bills at the end of every month so that we didn't have them looming. We had purchased it with cash. He passed. I had no debt. My car, I've purchased how many cars since? 2 cars since he passed, my own money, debt-free. Why? Because the more you have hanging on you, the more stressed you are. That may not be possible for everybody, and that may not be possible for many people at all, but the less you have hanging on you, the better you're able to sleep at night, and the less you feel frightened of the future and possible I'll call it missteps. That's about it. Those are my non-negotiables in 7 categories and in on what I would call a daily basis. Is this effort? Yes, it's effort. Is it easy? It's not easy. It's simple. You make decisions and you go for them. It's worth it. It's worth it. You know, recently I did a podcast and I said something about a vest that I was wearing. And I, when I'd put it on, I'd realized that I had that vest. Oh, I can show you this. This was, I didn't even think about that. This is, I don't know if you could see that. We used to have a magazine in this town called Inland Empire Magazine. And that's me on the cover in front of my English garden. They had interviewed me as a landscape designer. And the vest I'm wearing, this little leopard vest, this was 2004. Well, I had that vest since 1995. That's still almost 20 years ago. And I was doing a video and I threw the vest on because I needed to have something different than what I had shot the previous video in so I could splice them together and know which one went to which video. And I thought to myself, wow, look at this. I still have this vest. And then I thought later, wait a minute, wow, that vest still fits me. And it still fits me well. In other words, with proper care, we can live healthy and long and not feel that we are at the mercy of time. We are to a degree. I mean, I look at the saggy skin here and there and I think, yeah, mercy of time, but that's fine. But we have so much control. So I'll bring it back around to that. And I would say if you're not doing any thing that would be on your non-negotiable list that maybe you are creating, take it low and slow. Will Bolshevitz, our fiber fuel writing, a gastroenterologist who is so popular right now, says this all the time, go low and slow. In other words, don't overdo, don't take on too much unless you're desperate and you really need results right now. Because what's going to happen is the more you do, the more you will be able to. And before you know it, you will be looking around you, realizing that the people you admire, you are now one of, because you were determined and you had imperatives and you followed them through. That's all I have to say. I hope you're having a great day. Oh, I know I am. And I want to thank you for your time. This was longer than I meant it to be. So have a great day. Bye.